Well, welcome the remnant of the Most High God. This morning, the air was crisp and clean and cold, and the coffee was hot. And so it was really a good start to a Sabbath morning this morning. Before I get started, there's a couple of things that I kind of want to preface. I had some of our partners after my last video sharing my anger with some of the emails I've gotten, and they were concerned that they were the ones that had upset me, and that's not true. I mean, we love our partners. We pray for them every day. And any of them have always said, you know, hey, I don't understand. This is what I've been taught in the Messianic movement or this movement or that movement. And sometimes the Messianic is just messy antics. And they've always asked me, and they have shown, they've shown respect and all that. And guys, I love you. And I'm not worried about you, but I have been cussed out. I have been called everything but a Bible teacher. And that's what upset me. And not those that are hungry for God and want to know, that are just asking questions. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about ridicule and people that just love to argue and then turn to cussing you out when you actually bring up facts. And so that's the state of the world that we're in today. And what's sad is so many of them call themselves Christians and yet they react like that. And I prefer someone says, I don't understand, I've never heard this before, less said, and then just get down in the Word and find out what God's saying. This is part 13 of Understanding the Kingdom, and I want to go this morning to Exodus chapter 3, starting in verse 16. And this is where we deal with God taking care of Pharaoh. How many know that what goes on in the world, and you see the story of Moses and the story of the children of Israel in Egypt is actually reassuring to me, because they're even though this had went on for an extended period of time, some estimate over 400 years, that there comes a time that God hears the cries of his people. And that he takes action. And I really think that we're to the point in history. Because there are certain things, that there are certain times that God moves. And guys, a lot of what I think we have in the last 20, 30 years have called a move of God has not been a move of God. Because whenever God moves, there's repentance, there's humility, there's a return to biblical holiness, and there's always a humbleness when you get into the Word of God. And what I'm seeing in almost every quarter right now of the body of Christ, to include a lot of what they're calling revival, I do not see those qualities. And so there are times in human history, and there's even times in ebbs and flows in our own lives, that God will draw near to us, and we have all enjoyed that. And sometimes we have been left in a quandary when he doesn't seem so near. But what that causes us to do is the Bible says there is a reward for those that diligently seek him. And I don't want to go as far as saying God plays hide and seek, but sometimes he's got to draw away to get you to move away from some of the things maybe that you have allowed in your life, and to get you out of, you know, Job said that one of his problems is that he was at ease in Zion, if you will, to get you to move a little closer to him so that you move away from some of the things of the world. And there's also times in human history that God lets the ebbs and flows of iniquity begin to build. And he does it until that cup of iniquity is full. There was one of the most interesting things that we see, and when Moses was taking the children to the promised land, he says, you know, we're going to take care of the Amalekites, but they're not ripe yet, that their iniquity is not full. And we're entering into a time just like Egypt here, we're going to read of, that iniquity is getting to the place to where it's reaching a fullness in the earth. And God is going to begin responding in like kind again. And so we pick up here in verse 16. He says, go and gather the elders of Israel together and say unto them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, of Jacob, appeared unto me, saying, sure, I have surely visited you and seen that which is done to you in Egypt. And let me say today that Almighty God has seen what is being done in the Middle East today. with ISIS. And not only is he seeing what is being done, he is seeing the true power that created ISIS and that is funding ISIS. And he will deal with both accordingly. Come on now. So some of the things that we're seeing on the world stage, some of it's the devil doing it, and some of it God's beginning to move the right players in the right place to take care of some things. And all I can say and what I'm feeling in my spirit is woe, woe, woe under those who planned, established, funded, and empowered what's going on right now. As well as they're trying to spread it throughout Europe and in America to destroy Western civilization. Woe unto you, in Jesus' name. We'll just leave that at that, okay? Picking up in verse 17, and I have said, I will bring you out of the affliction of Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, unto a land flowing with milk and honey. Now notice each one of those peoples. They represent, when you begin examining their names and what they represented, he said, I'm going to take you out of this affliction. Now you're going to have some challenges that you're going to have to overcome. You're going to have to drive out the ites that inhabited your promises while you were in captivity. And guys, we tend to think that if we... once you accept Jesus, everything is going to be glitter and butterflies and puppies. How many know that's not true? For you to grow up, for the children of Israel to grow up, they had to be able to face those challenges and drive those things out of the promise, the land that God gave them. God has a life for you. There's a desire that he wants for you. Just because you get saved doesn't mean there's not going to be struggles. Those struggles are to build you and equip you to rule and reign in this life as under him. But the only way to do that is you've got to learn in that conflict. You've got to learn in that doing. There are things that God wants to establish in you. And in those conflicts, you begin to learn how easily the world begins to creep in on you and to begin to steal your joy. How many of us have had a great day and somebody else stole our joy for that week? You know when you grow? Is when you don't let them steal it for more than about 30 seconds, because that's really all that they should have had the effect of. I mean, I've had a phone call that in times past would have really destroyed my joy for a week. And anymore, I have learned that it steals my joy about as long as it takes to hang up the phone. I'm not going to let them have that power over me. I'm not going to let the Hittites and the Pezusites and the Perizzites and all the other ites, I'm not going to let them steal what God's trying to do in my life. They're going to be out there, but my task is to drive them out of my borders and not to let them affect me. And so he says, listen, it's going to be a flowing, there's going to be blessing there, but there's also going to be giants. And almost all of these, what's interesting is all these nations also had Nephilim descendants embedded within them to drive them out. There's going to be giants, there's going to be things, but you know what? All it takes is a man or woman of God with a rock and a sling and a covenant with God to drive them out. Aren't you happy about that? Picking up in verse 18, And they shall hearken to thy voice, and thou shalt come, and thou and the elders of Israel, unto the king of Egypt, and ye shall say unto him, the Lord God of the Hebrews have met with us. And now let us go, we beseech thee, 3 days' journey in the wilderness, that we may sacrifice unto the Lord our God. And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, no, nor not by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go. Now, we're in a time where everybody wants to see signs and wonders. Signs and wonders, and see, this is the first mention of signs and wonders in the Bible. Selah. You know, now, before, all God had to do was give Pharaoh a dream saying, I'm going to shut up the womb of all your wives, and I'm going to end your dynasty if you don't let Abraham get out of that. That's all he had to do. But now we're in a situation that this is really the first mention of signs and wonders. Signs and wonders are always there to break the hold of Pharaoh. They're not there for Christian entertainment. And some places where God begins to move in signs and wonders to break the Pharaoh's hold on people needing Jesus, a lot of times they can't even get in there because the Christians stampede it. I've been to some meetings, you know, where I'm not the speaker, I'm on the outside wanting to get in, and sometimes they get a little rowdy. They get a little aggravated if they're not first in line. This isn't a show. Signs and wonders are for the unbeliever. They're to demonstrate the power of God because there are other powers in this earth. And if you don't think somebody needs to have see the manifested power of God, find somebody under the power of addiction. That demon has them underfoot. They need to see something of greater power to give them hope that God can set them free. That's the purpose of signs and wonders. It's not to build a ministry. It's not to fill a stadium full of believers, because signs and wonders are for the unbeliever. That's why tongues and interpretation are for those outside the camp, if you will. All we need is a prophetic word, and we know exactly what's going on. But tongues and interpretation is for the unbeliever, because it's a sign and it's a wonder. It's time that we begin going back to a biblical pattern, guys. Why are we establishing this? Because we're getting in ready to come into a time we're going to begin seeing signs and wonders again, because some pharaohs need to be judged. There are some things in all of our lives that are holding us back, that are trying to keep us captive. And here is something, one of the things we learned with Pharaoh. How many of us have had things we're believing God for and they won't let us go and they won't let us go and they won't let us go? That follows the pattern of Pharaoh. He would not. In fact, God, to make a point, because God had a plan here of what he was going to do, he even hardened his heart so that he wouldn't let him go. There are some things that you're going to have to stand and you're going to have to hit over and over and over again to bring them to submission. Now, to begin with, to get you initially saved, God will put them at bay. But when you get into the promised land, God says, it's time for you to roll up your sleeves and I'm going to work with you. And we're going to attack this thing together. And I really think that's where we're at in a lot of areas. Now, we need to understand the tendency of the world system. Egypt is a type and shadow of the standard world system. God calls us out of the earth, out of bondage to follow him. But one of the things that we see is the world system, everything about the world, will first seek to entice you. How many know that when Joseph's family came down to Egypt, they went from herding sheep and goats. They walked into a metropolis, an ancient metropolis with wonders. They had all this architecture and all these different things. They had armies. They probably even had their Egyptian version of 7-Eleven and Quick Stops and all these different shops and stuff. Well, these guys were used to living out in a field. Now, it was God's promised land, and it was a place of plenty, but you had to work for it. Now you have a whole other paradigm. The world will always seek to entice you. The spirit of this age has its pretties. And for some of us, it's different things. For some, men fall into pornography. For some, that's not a problem with them, but they seek power and they seek money, and they will do anything to get it. Each one of us has an enticement that the world will seek to bring. The Bible says, let us cast aside every weight or every sin that so easily besets us. Each one of us have a particular one that the enemy will seek to entice us with. But we need to understand that enticement is about the equivalent of a lure on the end of a fisherman's rod, and you're the fish. It will jump, it will sparkle, it will make you think it's going to be everything that you ever hoped for until you take the bite. And what you realize, especially when you're dealing with the world system, You think you have a hold of it, but eventually you realize it has a hold of you. And we have a lot of ministers today. We have a lot of those in leadership that have bitten the lure of the enemy one way or another. And they have found themselves enslaved into a world system that God wanted to set them free of. And it's time for us to wake up and realize that. The second thing that the Egyptian or the world system will always seek to do is it will take the blessings of the one true God to enhance its own system. Now, in Bible days, one of the reasons why that by the time we get to that Pharaoh, the reason he is so stinking filthy rich is because there was a king of Egypt that was kind of wealthy. But under his leadership rose a guy named Joseph that God put there to save his people, or Joseph's people. Egypt just kind of got in on it. And you begin reading in Genesis that the whole world came to him to buy food because Joseph had saved in the 7 years of plenty, had saved the grain, had saved the food. And but by the time you end up on the end of the 7 years of famine, everyone had sold, not only sold their property to the Pharaoh, they had become indentured servants to Pharaoh. All of Egypt was basically, he went from king to owner of everything. Now the original king so loved Joseph and so loved Jacob that when Jacob died, he mourned, and all of Egypt mourned, and he was actually a part of the funeral procession all the way back up to the promised land to bury Israel. But you go a couple of generations, and they're spoiled brats, and they forget where the wealth came from. And they have this idea that the wealth came from them. We need to understand, when you look at world history, There has been dynasties that have built great wealth over the period, but it always ended up in this dichotomy. All those that had everything, and then the rest of us that had nothing. In fact, even under the Catholic Church in Rome, that's still what you had. In fact, there were periods in Rome that when they would have some of their priests come down, maybe the first time to ever visit Rome, while Europe is sitting there in almost absolute starvation, they were in luxury and wealth to the place where it even sickened their own priests. There was no middle class. The only two times in history that we really see a middle class is, number one, under the rule of David and Solomon. It's called Israel's Golden Age, when men was walking, where they were walking in Torah from the king on down. Everybody had everything that they needed. There was a middle class. Now, under Solomon, he had so many people giving him gifts for his wisdom around the world that he literally piled up gold and silver in his back courtyard. Could you imagine somebody that's piling up gold and silver? There's hills of it. And the king says, oh yeah, that's my extra treasury. That's where the overflow is. We don't need guards because people have what they need, and it's just piled up in the backyard. The only other time was something called the Protestant movement that began causing people to walk with God once again. That each one of us, we need to be like Abraham. We need to walk with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob for ourselves. Your mama can't do it. Your daddy can't do it. Your preacher can't do it. It's you walking with God. And it was this personal, dynamic, living relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ that these people began to prosper because God would bless them. And it created a middle class. Now, right now, there is a war on the middle class with the elite because they choose to be Pharaoh again. And it's not the poor that's their problem, because the poor can be controlled. It's the middle class, so you tax them out of existence. You do all these things. Right now, we just had this last week, a new czar established in America to be head of the counterterrorism. And so I'm thinking, good deal. They're going to start going after Islamic militants. When was the last time you read that somebody started shooting up a place because they were drawing pictures of Jesus? When was the last time that you went into a place and they said, well, we blew up that place because they refused to repent and be baptized and make Jesus Christ their Lord and Savior? That never happens, does it? Or, you guys aren't going to follow the Constitution, I'm just going to blow this place up. That doesn't happen. But yet we have an administration that says, here's the real terrorists in America. Our veterans, the ones who fought for this nation. Those who believe in the Constitution. Those that are patriots and the Christians. Because the Christians are so much of a problem, because what we do is we start feeding the poor. We start building children's homes and hospitals and educational systems and try to lift people up. We're such a problem to those who want to oppress the world. Can you see a pattern? We got to get rid of the middle class, because serfs are easy to control. You starve them out, and they're just sitting there. It's almost like the old Oliver story, you know. Could I have another cup of porridge, please? Sometimes we can call it a welfare system. But what we're going to see develop in America and Europe are the ones who have everything, and then they're going to try to take everything away from no one. And they call it socialism. That's what happened in Russia. That's what happened in China. You had a few take power. They took everything. They lived in luxury while everybody else starved. And they call that progress. Well, you know, you can call yourself a progressive, and you're a cow waiting in line for slaughter, and you're progressing down the line. And you can think because the line's moving, you're really making progress, until you see what's at the end of the line. The only option is to get out of line and walk with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They're trying to take the blessing that God gave upon the Protestants, because they were actually trying to walk with God, that created the middle class, that created industry. You know the reason why the best watches in the world are made in Switzerland? There was a guy named Calvin that was a preacher. Now, I don't agree with all of Calvinism, but that area in Switzerland was known for its brothels. And so they all get saved. How many know that when a whole bunch of people get saved, brothels don't function anymore, taverns don't function anymore? And so he said, okay, basically I'm destroying the industry of my area by bringing them the gospel. So we're going to start making something, and he found that the people had a propensity for watchmaking. And it was the industry of the Christians and the ingenuity of the Christians that established Swiss watchmaking as the crown jewel, if you will, of the Swiss area. It was the Christians that did that. Now the world's come through and they've tried to take it away, and we see that in so many other areas. You know, it's time for us to wake up, guys. Because the world will always try to take the blessings of God out of your life and sell you the lie that they're the ones that did it for you. And it belongs to them. You need to share your blessing with God with those who aren't walking with God. I will absolutely share my blessing with God. The greatest blessing is you need to know the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to have every sin washed away. You need to be in blood covenant with Him. And when you start walking in this, the curses will stop in your life. What's a greater blessing than that? All the rest of it will fall into place. But they seek to take that. And any time that you have this Pharaoh-type spirit, he will never let you go easily. The things that bring the greatest bondage in your life will not give up easily. But when you start crying out to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, is the time that if you continue to cry and you continue to push, you're about to see some signs and wonders in your life. I don't know about you, but I just love that. Now, when we look at the 10 plagues that God brought on Egypt, one of the interesting things is that in Egypt, their belief system had 80 gods. Gods for everything. And as you go through the plagues, what you discover, not only was God judging the land, He was bringing an indictment against every one of their gods. Now, when you understand the Babylonian system, you understand the Egyptian system, you are either dealing with second power principalities, you're dealing with watchers, you're dealing with Nephilim, you're dealing with these type of things that they worshiped, that they began establishing these systems. And so God even here begins to judge them, saying, who are these, you know, who is an angel, a fallen angel compared to Almighty God? And see, the same confrontation that we're seeing in this conflict of these kingdoms, we're going to see in the last days, because God, the man is beginning to follow some of the old gods under new names, as well as being trying to create his own using technology. There's going to be some new gods that are really old gods that are dressed up in techno suits. I even believe that we're probably going to see the AI, and I know I've written some about this, but I do not think that a computer by itself with software alone can ever establish self-awareness, that it actually becomes a consciousness. I do not think that is possible. But what I do think is possible is the right software and the right hardware creates a platform for a spiritual entity to enter into it, and for that entity to be able to express consciousness in this world through that mechanism. So the very image of the beast that can speak may very well be an AI, but let me tell you something, it is not an electronic AI. It is some type of watcher. It is some type of spiritual being that was created, that fell, that they finally got it to the place to where it could inhabit it. And I've even wondered if they're not going to use synthetic biology. You know, there are two things that they have to have. The transhumanist movement is talking about eventually making us all robots and figuring out how to transfer consciousness into a brain that will not deteriorate. That'll take two things, synthetic DNA and synthetic biology. And they, the last 2 years, they've been able to create both. A synthetic brain. But what they don't realize is they just created the perfect housing that is more durable and more powerful than the human body that a demonic spirit or a watcher can inhabit. And they're going to bow down to it and say it's their God. You say, Mike, that is preposterous. Google it. They're already saying, and they're bragging about, we are going to learn to create gods, little g. And let me tell you something, just like God not only judged Pharaoh, who was the personification of Osiris within their belief system, that he was the morning star, he was the god, big G, of Egypt as far as he was concerned, as well as all their 80 gods, God judged and showed how fallible they were and showed that they had no power compared to him. One of the reasons why when you get to the book of Revelation, it's all amped up on steroids. I mean, it's beyond what was done in Egypt when you see the book of Revelation. You have two prophets running around that can launch any of these 10 plagues at will. That you come against them, you send a drone at them, fire comes out of their mouth and they devour it. How many know that's a little bit rougher? And then you add on top of all that the seven bowls of wrath. And seven is a biblical number showing completeness, that all the wrath that God has been holding since the beginning of when Adam and Eve fell, all that wrath of all the people that have rejected him and done all these atrocities in the earth, all that wrath is being held up in these seven bowls in heaven. And see, seven is completeness. The complete wrath of God will be poured out in a short period in the book of Revelation. Because he is going to decimate every one of the man-made gods and the watchers and the 70 principalities and all the Nephilim spirits. He is going to judge them all, just like he did Pharaoh. You see, when I read the book of Exodus, it brings hope to me. Anytime that we enter into Passover and we celebrate communion, it brings hope to me, because the same Jesus that we're celebrating, that is the Passover lamb, is coming back as the conquering king that will bring the Pharaoh of this world and all his demigods to their knees, whether they are some of the ancient ones, the Arche or the Archons, whether he brings them down or he's bringing down the new ones created by this techno revival that is going on, which is nothing more than a new wave of watcher technology that is to enhance and help the Antichrist. He will judge it all and bring it to its knees. How many know God's in control? Because it's one kingdom, the kingdom of God, versus the kingdom of darkness. I like what my pastor John Looper said. He said when you read the entire Word of God, there's two mysteries that flow from Genesis to Revelation: the mystery of iniquity and the mystery of godliness. I don't know about you, but I want to be on the side of godliness. I want to be crying out to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, in the very first one, when Moses turned the water into blood, we need to understand several things. That one of the quintessential things of Egypt was the Nile. It gave them their life. That when it would flood, it would fertilize the area. Many times, especially right around the river, they could actually take their foot and make a little trench for the water to run into, to water. And so the Nile was very central. They believed that the god Kunam was the guardian of the river Nile, that Hapi was the spirit of the Nile, the very dynamic essence of the Nile, and that the Nile represented the literal the blood stream, if you will, of Osiris. So it was very, very important to their mythology. And the first thing God does is he turns the water into blood. He judged Osiris. He judged Hapi. He judged the Kunam. He judged them all with the very first judgment. And see, what we don't realize, because we've been so disenfranchised, Moses said that when Jesus comes, when the Messiah comes, he's going to be just like me. What was the first miracle that Jesus did? Turned water into wine. Within the mind, with the Semitic people, water into blood and water into wine are the same thing. That Jesus was repeating the very first miracle he did, the very first sign and wonder he did, was the very first sign and wonder of Moses. Showing, I'm the one that Moses promised that when he came. In fact, what's really cool in the Hebrew, one of these days, I'm going to take it apart and put it in my next book. There's this word play. Have you ever noticed sometimes in the Psalms, it'll be like David talking, and then within a verse or two, all of a sudden God's talking? We see that in the Hebrew with Moses when he's sharing about Messiah, because Moses is sharing and said he's going to be just like me. He's going to be that faithful servant, that faithful bondservant of God. And then all of a sudden God begins prophesying out of the mouth of Moses, and all of a sudden Yahweh is saying, and he's going to be just like me. I don't know about you, but that just sends chills down my spine. He is Yahweh and Moses all wrapped up together. The only one that could ever fill the bill is J-E-S-U-S, Jesus. The second plague was the frogs. Now, here's the interesting thing. The frogs were considered the theophany of the goddess Hecate, or H-E-Q-T. Hecht, I guess. I'm not Egyptian. I didn't learn Egyptian names when I was in seminary. I was trying to struggle with all the names of the Bible characters, you know. But so the frog represented this goddess, which is the wife of the creator of the world and the goddess of birth. Frogs were so sacred in Egypt that even if someone involuntarily slaughtered a frog, the punishment was death. So, you know, in Egypt, it wasn't holy cow, it was holy frog. And now they're coming out, by the tens of thousands, and they're dying all over the place that you can't even hardly move without killing a frog. And then all of a sudden they start dying all over the place. So here you have your most sacred representation of your God as a frog, which kind of is interesting, and they're dying all over the place. How many know God has a sense of humor? And it's followed up by, some translations say, lice. You have all the little flea things. Many believe that they were sand fleas, and what you would have in the desert. And one of the things they do is they burrow under the skin. We had a lot of our vets when they were in Desert Storm and so forth. We had to deal with all the infections and the problems of sand fleas embedding themselves and causing disease within them. They're also known as the dust of the soil. Now, what's interesting with this one, now all the first three, the children of Israel had to deal with in one shape or measure. It's like, you know, they were told, go get water before the water was turned to blood. So they had to deal with the sand fleas. But what's so interesting or humorous about the sand fleas, it's one of the specific things that now the priests in Egypt would have to shave their heads and shave their face every day, and they would have to clean themselves every day, and they would wear these light tunics. But sand fleas is one of the things, if they had an infestation of sand fleas, according to Egyptian religious practices, they could not conduct their priestly duties. In other words, with the third plague, all worship of the Egyptian gods stopped. There was no sacrifice to Ra. There was no sacrifice to Osiris. Hathor just had to go without. Because none of the priests could minister, because everybody had embedded sand fleas. Oh, you're going to get this in a minute. When God begins to really move, one of the reasons why righteousness takes a hold of an area with revival is because when God begins to move and begins to judge the systems of this world, that worship to the gods of this world stop with revival. That's why historically, when revival has come and God has done miracles like under Finney and so forth, the taverns shut down. Prostitution goes down to zero. Drug pushers can't push drugs anymore. They get saved and start pushing Jesus. That's why with the Swiss, they had to go to watchmaking because a lot of that was moved to Amsterdam. And if you know, like in Amsterdam, one of the things they're famous for is the red light district. How many know they just need revival in Amsterdam? Shut all that down, replace it. But when God begins to move, so the third one, I think it's interesting, it was the third one. Jesus was in the grave how many days? So when we yield to the completed work of Christ, the worship of other gods stop. Oh, I don't know about you, but I'm having fun. The fourth one was swarms. Now, I'm going to read it here from the King James. It says, "Else if thou wilt not let my people go, behold, I will send swarms." Now, of flies is in italics in the King James Version. That means it is of flies is not in the original text. So there's actually a lot of debate about exactly what the swarms were. And it says, "And this swarms shall be upon thee and upon thy servants and upon thy people and into thy houses. And the houses of Egypt shall be full of swarms. Also the ground thereof they are." Now, several commentators have looked at this and said, what was it? Many believe it wasn't swarms of flies. It was swarms of scarabs. Did you ever see that huge beetle that has the big, like, chomper claws? They had swarms of that. Now, what's amazing, those things can do some damage. They got some chompers on the front of them. In fact, when they move through an area, huge numbers, they're worse than termites. It'll be in your houses. So, I mean, they'll go through wood like a chainsaw. Now, what's also, you know, as I was studying this, what's also interesting is that the Egyptian people, they deified the scarab. That it represented Amun-Ra, the creator and the king of the gods, who many times was represented as having a head of a beetle. And to show you sometimes how the pagan mind can work, they said that he controlled the movement of the sun. He's the one who rolled the sun from the east to the west. And how they got that is the scarab is also known as the dung beetle. And so as they watch these dung beetles taking their little roll of dung, and they're saying, well, that's my God who's just moving his dung from the east to the west. That's where they got the idea that, well, if that little dung beetle can do it, then Amun-Ra, you know, he takes his flaming dung and he well, makes you view things a little bit different, doesn't it? So when God did this, he slapped Amun-Ra upside the head. He took one of the most sacred objects, the dung beetle or the scarab. So next time somebody's getting into Egyptian mythology and they talk about the scarab, just call it by its real name, a dung beetle. It lives and thrives to roll little balls of dung, and that's all it does with its entire life. If you want to get all mystic about that, go ahead and be my, I got better things to do. The fifth plague was the death of livestock. How many know domestic livestock is the heart of any community? It represents the wealth. Now, in Egypt, horses and cattle were not only highly valued, but they were sacred. Now, I want you to understand the Egyptian mythology. You know, you look at the Greek mythology and you have like Aphrodite, you know, that's supposed to, or Venus. In Egyptian mythology, it was Hathor, who was also represented by the cow. The cow to them was just sex on a stick, I guess. I don't know. But next time somebody calls a woman an old cow, just say thank you. Because I'm a sex symbol. So in this judgment, Hathor could not protect her own emblem and the prosperity of Egypt because all the cattle except for the cattle in Goshen died. The horses died. Then it's followed up by boils. These boils, and some researchers have speculated that this was skin anthrax, probably from all the cows that died. And skin anthrax is a black abscess that develops into pustules. The plague is accompanied with painful boils that affect the knees, the legs, and the soles of the feet. They couldn't even walk. So here you have everything dying all around you, and you can't even put on your sandals because you have boils all over the bottom of your feet. And this was an affront to Inhotep, Imhotep, which was the god of medicine in Egypt, because the priests couldn't cure the boils. In fact, it gets to a place, you know, it's like, look, you want sand fleas? I can make more sand fleas. The land is already covered in sand fleas. Don't bring me a priest that can make more sand fleas. But they got to the place where they couldn't replicate what God could do. And let me tell you something, as much as we have becoming technologically advanced people, and we're getting ready to see things that are multidimensional, that are beyond our understanding. But let me tell you something. There's going to come a time to a place when God is doing stuff that they can't replicate it. Because you still cannot do God. The seventh one is hail. And it was an insult to Nut, the sky goddess, and as well as the, I forgot the one that's also the wind goddess, or God. See, each one of these was a judgment on the false gods. Eight was locust. And see, what was amazing is all these things are happening, and we can get into the goddess of childbirth and the goddess of the crops, and Isis again is silent, and the goddess of fertility and the harvest is speechless. Seth, another god of the crops, is also mute. Every one of these plagues, their gods couldn't do a thing. And let me tell you something, there are some things God's getting ready to do that no watcher, no principality is going to be able to stop. Darkness. Now, why is darkness? How many days was it dark? When Jesus was in the tomb, what was his body covered in for 3 days? Darkness. Interesting. But their chief god, Amun-Ra, the sun god, was judged and proved to be helpless. The final one, the death of the firstborn, from Pharaoh on down, not one of their gods could protect. It was an indictment on every single Egyptian god that claimed to have power to enslave God's people. You see, God is in the accounting business. God not only came to set his people free, but to judge the nation that enslaved them. And the 10 plagues of Egypt, guys, the 10 plagues that God poured on them stripped every ounce of wealth that Egypt got from the blessing of Joseph. Plus interest. What was not destroyed by God was carried out with his people when they left. Egypt never fully recovered. I don't know about you, but I like that. This devastation land of Egypt cannot be compared to what is coming when the wrath of God is poured out on the God of this world, and he will strip away all of the blessings the Almighty has put upon this earth through his people, and he will judge the world system and bring it to its knees. That's why when I read Moses, don't get, guys, if you're a believer, quit bad-mouthing Moses. He was a faithful servant that God used to destroy and to judge the gods of this world. And he's a type and shadow of what Jesus is going to be when he comes back. We know what's coming. Our job is to press into that God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob now and ensure that we are free and following him when he comes with all of our hearts. That's our task before us. And so, you know, Mary and I see this temporal loop where God's given us more time. That's not time to sit back and to fall asleep and to go back as church as usual. It is time to regroup, press into God with all your heart, and be in the position that you can be, that there is a Goshen. When God begins to pour out his wrath, he will always have a Goshen for his people. And see, our job is to become that Goshen. One of the things Mary and I were sharing on our podcast, when you walk with God and you get free in God and you begin walking in covenant, you create an atmosphere of the kingdom around you. So our job is to expand the kingdom around us, to be a buffer zone from the world and the acts that God is going to do when he judges this world system. And guys, there is some judgment coming. Our job is to become a spiritual Goshen for the people of God. Everybody's saying, where's that going to be? Where's that city going to be? I want to run there. You're required to be right where you are right now. Quit trying to run for something God is trying to make you. You're wanting someone else to do it. You're wanting them to press into God so that you can ride on the coattails of. There will be no coattail riding in the days ahead. You got to walk it. And if God begins gathering people together, each one adds to it because they're bringing their own peace that they have accumulated in the kingdom of God. And so each one brings in and enhances and expands the kingdom. They don't take away from it. Because like Abraham, they're going to walk out of Babylon. They're walking out of the world system, and they're walking with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and that brings the blessing. That's where we are right now. So that's why it's so important for us to get in the Word, understand the kingdom, get into the Torah, so that we can separate clean from unclean, holy from unholy, the ways of God from the ways of this world, and embed ourselves so deep into the ways of God that when God judges the world, there's no world in us for him to judge. That's our task in this hour. And Father, I thank you for your Word. I thank you that will not return to you void, but will accomplish whereunto you have sent it. And Father, I believe that I'm just believing with this message today that there's an anointing being loosed, not only for us here, but for those that listen by video and listen by audio, that we will press into you and we will establish the kingdom, the rule and reign of Jesus. And there are no other gods before you. There is nothing before you, Almighty God. And that we will serve you with our whole heart and create an atmosphere of the kingdom around us. In Jesus' name.